As an organization and as a Sangathan, the RSS is arguably stronger in a state like Kerala than it is virtually in any other part of the country. And yet, physical presence on the ground, for some reason, hasn't translated into electoral gains yet for its political arm, the Bharatiya Janata Party. Why is that the case? Why is Kerala, and as an extension, Tamil Nadu, grounds where the Hindutva ideology that the RSS believes in so strongly hasn't been able to take firm root, unlike Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, and now even West Bengal? To talk about this, we're joined at the India Today Conclave South by one of the senior most RSS leaders, the man in charge of giving policy frameworks to the RSS and working very closely on the ground in Kerala. Jay Nandkumarji, welcome to the India Today Conclave South, and it's great to have you with us. So thank you. I want you to talk about why, in your estimate, the RSS's physical presence on the ground in a state like Kerala hasn't yet yielded political gains for your political arm, the BJP. What holds it back?
Namaskar to all, and I would like to thank India Today to organize a discussion on this particular topic and great enough to invite me for this discussion. At the first place, I would like to say that BJP is not a political arm of RSS. RSS is a cultural organization working in the field of the transformation of mind, I would like to say. That's the one thing. Our mindset is to be changed. We should imbibe the nationalist spirit inside. Then everything will be okay, and the political atmosphere will also be cleared. That's another thing. And as far as Kerala, I would like to come to your question that as far as Kerala is concerned, yes, RSS Shakhas, as far as a Pranta, in our division, state is known as, called as Pranta. Kerala has got the maximum number of Shakhas. But you know, the demographic balance of Kerala is very much against a political organization like BJP to grow. I don't want to go much deep into the percentage and all. But the presence of the organized religions, organized religions, I would like to mention, and also the clandestine understandings with the so-called mainstream political parties there, Congress, Communist Party, with these groups, these religious groups, and transferring the votes against the BJP's victory is a fact for the last several years. It is happening there. So that's why BJP is trying to make their way through so many, as a political party is concerned, they have to make some adjustments, understandings, and all.
Jagat Prakash Nadda, who's the BJP president, was at the India Today Conclave South, and he said also the same thing, that where the BJP is strong, the left transfers its votes to... if the Congress is weak, then they transfer it to the left and vice versa.
Yes.
Is this not, sir, political conspiracy and a case of sour grapes? If you can't win straight, you say your opponents are fixing the match.
See, as far as the democratic system and the election is concerned, who crossed the, what you say, the last point or first coming, who is first finishing the thing, they will win. When you are doing against your political ideological beliefs and transferring votes to defeat someone, it is not just a case of sour grapes thing. That is happening, and there are so many examples for that, I would like to say. See, in Manjeshwaram in the last election, Surendran, the BJP president, was about to win. But he was defeated with a narrow margin of 92 votes. And there the Communist Party was as good as losing their deposit, wherein which they won in some of the last elections. They have transferred the election. It's quite clear, it is quite obvious that it happened. But I'm not a politician to analyze it all, but still, as a political student, I would like to say that these type of examples, n number of examples are there in Kerala, several constituencies I can say, but last in the last election in Nemam, BJP was a name of its constituency, in which they were able to cross that unholy nexus of these two fronts.
What's your sense, sitting on the opposition side of the political fence, of how the left government of Pinari Vijayan has done over the past 5 years? Because all the latest polls and political trends seem to suggest that the left could be back for another term in office. So what's your sense of how this left government has done, and why is it that the left is still left in Kerala, whereas, you know, you've been able to take it out of places like West Bengal and Tripura?
At first place, I have already said, Rahul, that I am not a politician. I am not a politician. You are asking only the political question. Whatever it may, what is in my knowledge, I would like to answer. See, there is a perception created by some corners that this left government is going to return. It is going to continue. But I am not sure about that, because at the ground level, there is a huge, disinterest about the left government because of so many reasons. One, first reason, Sabarimala issue, and other, their understanding with the ultra-terrorist organization, especially the Islamist organization. All this will be detrimental for the leftist government, and I don't think that it is going to continue. And also huge loans they have taken even from outside through KIFBI arrangements and all. The general public has come out, especially the knowledge, the people who are literate enough to know these factors have come up like anything against the left government, I feel so.
Now, let's come to the cycle of political killings, which is so close to your heart and one of the key things that you work on. Now, the right would have people believe that it is the left which is continuously provoking, attacking people from the RSS. The police in Kerala and data seems to suggest it's a cycle of political killings. Yes, of course, there have been some very unfortunate incidents of RSS workers or BJP workers being attacked, hacked. I've personally come down to Kerala, reported on this. But there have been counter-attacks as well. So do you accept that this is a cycle of political attacks and counter-attacks?
See, whatever you call it, is a cycle of counter-attacks or attacks, and all these actions have got reactions, all these things and these scientific definitions set apart with that. You have to think about the history, how it started. At the end of the day, you have to come to the conclusion where it started, how it started, what is the psychology behind that, whether an ideology worked behind that. So I would like to mention one particular incident or anecdote. When RSS was started in Kerala only in 1942, in the preliminary years itself, when RSS was at its infant stage, having only got 3 or 4 shakhas in Kerala, when Guruji Golwalkar came to Kerala for his usual visit, Guruji Golwalkar, you know, the chief of RSS, All India President, you may say, that particular program, having only 200 or 300 persons were attacked by Communist Party with a 2,000, 3,000 people, I mean, goons. And it was attacked. So it started from there. And also the first political murder took place in Telicherry, in which the present chief minister, then a youth leader of Marxist Party, was the first accused in that political murder. It took place in 1968 when Vadikal Ramakrishnan of Telicherry was killed. So these incidents, without any provocation from the so-called, right wing or the Sangha side, continuously these type of provocations were going on. First place, an ideology which is believing in class war or annihilating the adversaries, the political adversaries. Ideologically itself, Communist Party cannot forsake that particular belief system of annihilating the class enemies. That is the way in which they are functioning there. Another thing, in order to get the political support from the so-called enemies of RSS, so-called enemies of the Hindu organization, that is the Semitic fanatic terrorist wing, enemy of the enemy become a friend of themselves for to get that political gain or election gain, they continuously, they were attacking the RSS people. Of course, for their survival, if you are not getting any proper support from the legal or executive system of police or anything, and the whole political machinery and administration is against you, pushing you to a corner, naturally some reactions must have taken. I'm not denying about that. But it was all started by a particular political ideology, a left ideology believing in annihilating, finishing the political adversaries, and also doing anything to any extent to attain political gain. That was the starting point. And when you are pushed to a corner, it was quite natural and humane to react. That happened. I'm not denying about the reactions.
So what is the way out of this cycle? This business of killings, counter killings, is one of the features of Kerala politics. Is there a way out that you think can be found from this cycle?
Yes, there is a way. There are ways, I would like to say, more specifically. One is democratic way itself is the way to achieve peace and all. RSS and the allied organizations were very much for such talks and peace talks and everything. People who are living outside of Kerala or outside the influential areas of this so-called left cannot believe in this type of discussion, just like in between America and Russia or Pakistan and India. But it has happened in Kerala, and Sangha RSS has taken initiative to invite these communist people to a table to discuss about it. You may be knowing that Dattopan Thengadiji, who was a ideologue of Hindu philosophy, he was an RSS person, and he was he founded RSS in Kerala. He was a BMS Sanstapak. He took initiative to call upon none other than EMS Nambudiripad in Delhi and started discussions there. So from our side, there are a lot of initiatives. In Kerala also, V.R. Krishnayyar took a mediator position and called communist people and RSS people. There was discussion, but you know, before that ink which has been used for signing such an agreement to make peace, before that ink dried, communist people killed one of the district level leader Chandran in Telicheri. It happened there, and Krishnayyar himself was, I lost all hope that has happened. See, I was an editor. I'm also in from a journalistic background, and I was the editor of Kesari Weekly, Malayalam Weekly, and through one of my columns, I have invited the communist people. We have to end up with. Just forget about all the past. Let us start a new beginning. But do you know the Pinarayi Vijayan, how he has reacted to it? Let RSS people put the weapon down. It is not a reaction from a person who is believing, if he is believing in democracy. It is not a reaction. It was not. When none other than Mohan Bhagwat visited some 3 years back in Kerala, he himself has said, when a journalist asked him about the same question, he himself said that I am inviting all people and stretching my hands for peace, and I am requesting the people, especially from the leftist background, to end up all these things. But immediately Pinarayi Vijayan was asked the same question, what is your reaction? Pinarayi Vijayan's reaction was, let Mohan Bhagwat put his weapon down. So this is the way in which this step of discussion itself has been sabotaged. So RSS is always for that. And during one Onam celebration, I would like to remind you about that particular thing. During one Onam celebration, you may be knowing, as far as Keralites are concerned, Onam is considered to be the most auspicious occasion. And it's more famous for Sadhya, big feast. 10 days continuously, RSS conducted Upavasa. RSS people conducted Upavasa for peace alone. Let us stop this. Senior elements should come forward and try to stop all these things. And I would like to mention another example. Udaya Bhanu, many of the, thinkers who are participating here may be knowing that name. He was a famous Gandhian contest leader of Kerala. He once wrote after a thorough study about the political killing in Kerala, and he came up with a conclusion that one conclusion is for sure, that the old RSS people, at least 90% of the RSS people who were killed or murdered in this political killings were former Marxist people. So it's a case of apostasy. It's a case of sin of apostates. Those who are leaving Communist Party and joining this Sangha are bound to or destined to be killed.
Now, West Bengal and Tripura were at one time as difficult territory for the BJP RSS as Kerala seems right now. What are the differences, according to you, between your ability to make the ground more amenable for for the growth in West Bengal and Tripura in comparison with Kerala?
To the first question itself, I have answered. The particular special and interesting, I would like to say, interesting demographic balance of Kerala is entirely different from Bengal and Tripura. And also in Bengal and Tripura, there was people who have experienced the communist dictatorship and all sort of terrorist activities supported by them for a pretty long period, you may be knowing. And thousands were butchered, murdered in that area. That is not the case of Kerala as such. That much number has not been butchered or murdered. And this contest for 5 years and the Communist Party for 5 years, it is somewhat in a zigzag model it is going on always. So in that way, people once experiencing the misrule of Communist parties do select Congress, and they were not considering BJP as a proper alternative there. That's a psychological problem also. So I feel that ground level change is happening, some sort of a tectonic change in the social system is happening there. The continuous work done by the BJP and its allied organization, RSS and all, and the change will happen this time, I do hope, because of the continuous work happened.
So the RSS and the BJP have now brought Metro Man Sridharan as their symbol. He's also 88 years old, so well beyond the age when you enter the Margdarshak Mandal. Do you think through his appeal to Malayali pride, the right project in Kerala will be able to penetrate deeper? Is that your hope?
I do feel that Metro Man has got a deep impact, a huge impact in the Kerala society. It's that you have said correctly, that a Malayali pride, the Metro Man who delivered, everything assigned to him has been done correctly, and the people are very well, feeling that change happening in the ground in Kerala, in the political ground. So many people, not only Metro Man, so many sincere people, IAS officers, IPS officers, kalakar, artists, have started coming to BJP nowadays for the last 2-3 years. It has happened. See, T.P. Senkumar, who was the IPS officer and also a DGP, without any reason, being victimized by the Pinarayi Vijayan and leftist government, through Supreme Court, he got the judgment in favor of him to be reinstated as DGP. Was a personality who did all sort of his duties with due respect and everything. He has come to BJP. Jacob Thomas was officer of vigilance, was the main person. He came to BJP. Not only Sridharan, there's a huge change going on. So it will have a deep impact in the Kerala polity, no doubt.
You sit in some of the most important decision-making bodies of the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh. In 2014, when Prime Minister Modi took over, the RSS thought it's the best opportunity to create a new Bharat in the image of the RSS worldview. 6 years down the line, 7 years down the line, how close do you think the RSS feels we are towards achieving the RSS's conception of a new India?
At the first place itself, I would like I should say that through political change alone, our concept about the nation building, will be fulfilled. That is not our concept about our work. If it would have been the case, Dr. Hedgewar, the RSS founder himself, was a staunch political person in his younger days. He was a part of Congress. He was the secretary of the Central Province. He was a leader of the political movement, the democratic movement and everything. He would have started a political party other than Congress. He started the RSS organization to change the mindset of the people, to elevate, to raise the national consciousness level of the people, the common national consciousness level. For if that is the case, political change alone will not, or the systemic change alone will not change the mindset of the people. So first and the foremost thing which is to be happened is the change of the mindset and the national consciousness level to be increased. For that case, for the last several years, through Sangha, that national consciousness level of the common people have raised to a considerable level. And we are again working on that line. As a natural impact in the political field, that has been reflected in the BJP's success only. And we are not planning something new as the NDA came into the power in 2014, something new. We are continuing our work, which we have started in 1925, with more vigor, that's all. And this political, the change in the political dispensation at the center has made any change in our policy, RSS policy. That's not the case. It is continuing the very same.
When you review the work of the government, what is it, according to you, the one standout achievement of the BJP government at the center? What is it that delights your heart the most?
One thing I would like to say, the cultural, educational aspects, the approach towards the cultural and the educational aspects have changed a lot. People started thinking about the ethos, the philosophical values of Bharat. It is a change initiated by the government through so many actions. For example, the National Education Policy came recently. For the first time in the history of the independent India, a Bharat-centric education policy has been formed. Before that, so many examples are there. See, Rama Janmabhoomi is a great achievement as far as the new political dispensation is concerned. Another thing, so many issues which were creating pain in a nationalist mind, just like Jammu Kashmir issue. And as far as a national movement is concerned, see, people are thinking on the basis of a religious belief system. Nationalism is much beyond religious belief system, but a particular group is thinking always about their religion and their own religious habits. And without considering even their own women folk, they are continuing with such activities. So now triple talaq has been removed. So many such new things. The Bharatiyas want to, those who are believing that they are basically Bharatiyas, those who need to come back to Bharat because of the religious persecution through ZAA, that has also been done. So there are number of
I were to reverse the question and say, what is it that the government has done or not done which irks you the most, which you are most disappointed with?
No, I'm not disappointed in
with
that
anything.
Sense. No, I'm not disappointed with anyone as a Sangha Swayam Sevak. That's first thing. My point is the intent, the niyat. The intent of the government is correct. So today or tomorrow that will happen. There is no doubt about that. I have mentioned about the educational and cultural aspects. I'm not satisfied to that extent that everything has been done. Only policy has been made. Now framework is to be formulated. Then the syllabus is to be created. New contents are to be generated. So that aspect is still pending, I would like to say, but I am not dissatisfied.
Does it concern you that there's a perception that India is going down an authoritarian road, that freedom of speech, dissent is being curtailed, sedition cases being filed left, right, and center, that we're now a more closed society than we were before you took over?
I'm not at all. This is not a fact at all. It's not a fact at all. So you are saying that when your dissent is being curtailed, democratic, liberal, what you say, freedom of expression is being curtailed. That's not a fact at all. If a journalist like you or the media persons are thinking, when was it happened when the freedom of expression was curtailed? I feel that the First Amendment of the Indian Constitution was against the journalistic freedom of expression. That has been done by the so-called most liberal person, Jawaharlal Nehru. The First Amendment against the freedom of expression. It happened in 1950 itself. 15 or 20 days after the nation became republic and we accepted the constitution. You may be knowing that fact. Against the Ramesh Thapar, Chennai, Madras government case, Jawaharlal Nehru came out with an amendment that it is not necessary to express all your thoughts against the government and all. That amendment has happened. Now there is no amendment or constitutional amendment against the freedom of expression is happening. The only thing is that such a perception has been created, such a perception, and it is a game played by some elements who are working in and out. That is my feeling.
Okay, we're out of time. You had an opportunity to speak about the Kerala project, the right-wing project in terms of creating a new India, and also what you think is right and some of what you think still needs to be worked. Anant Kumarji, for having made the effort of coming to us in the middle of a pandemic and joining us here in presence at the India Today South Conclave. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.